Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this morning, Lord. We're just so blessed. We've talked about so much to be blessed about already today, Lord. But we're not done, Lord. We're ready to look into your word, to your truth, the words that you've given us about you, about our lives in you, God. And so right now, Lord, we just pause, and in our souls, like we sang earlier, from our souls, we invite you to teach us about you and about our lives in you on this earth, Lord. Use your word, your Holy Spirit, even your humbled servant this morning, Lord, and teach us, grow us, and most importantly, Lord, be glorified by what takes place here this morning. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, and everybody said, amen. So years ago, when I right out of college, I got a job at a hotel downtown San Diego, the Horton Grand, being a valet and a bellman. And they gave us these really stupid period, it was like a period-themed hotel, and they gave us these really goofy uniforms to wear. Do you want to see them? Okay, I happen to have a picture. By the way, that's me on the far right there, fresh out of college. You're like, yeah, that's about right, probably, yeah. But I want to tell you a story about something that happened while I was working there. I only worked there about a year, but I worked with this really fun group of young guys. We were highly motivated, had a lot of energy. And what happened, how the hotel would work is we're standing in sort of front of this parking area where the cars would pull up to check in. And there was another bell desk back inside the glass windows back there where usually we would hang out in there until a car pulled up. And then one of us would usually go out and deal with the people. And we kind of mixed up our jobs. Sometimes we parked the car. Sometimes we took the luggage. And we always pooled all our tips together. And one time around this time, it was when that movie Back to the Future came out, and there was this one scene in the movie that I want to show you this scene and then tell you what we did with it. But remember Marty McFly shows up in his hometown in the 50s? Remember this? I'll show you the clip. It's real quick.
Mr. Sandman, bring me a drink. Make her complexion like peaches and cream. Give her to me like clover. Then tell me that my lonesome nights are over. Sandman, I'm so alone. Don't have nobody to call my own. Your magic beam.
Yeah, I'm glad you chuckled at that little part right there. So one day at the bell desk inside, one of the bellmen said, wouldn't it be funny like if we did that when a car would pull up? So the next car that pulls up, three of us come just like that doing the stupid jog, you know? And one guy went to the trunk to wait for the trunk to open, and I went to the driver's side, and somebody ran around and got the lady's door, and we kind of did this little bit. Welcome to the Horton Grand. We're here to, you know? And we just thought it was so funny that we did it again and again. And what was kind of funny in retrospect as well is some people just thought it was hilarious. They got out, and they're like, hey, what's the gag, you know? What are you guys doing? You know, we're like, we're messing around. But other people are just like, you know? Well, anyways, we kept doing it because it was fun, and, you know, we're young and stupid and bored, and it was kind of, you know, it's not a, you know, high-intellect job for crying out loud, and we just did it for fun, but an interesting thing happened. I bet you could probably pick up on it already. Guess what? At the end of the day, when we started to pool our tips, we did pretty good. Like, people were, like, kind of, like, stoked at that, and so we kind of kept doing it, and what's, you know, looking back on it, I remember we stopped doing all the goofy, you know, the goofy running, you know, but when a car would pull up, instead of the old style, which was one guy would kind of go out, instead, every time a car pulled up, everybody that was up front would jump, you know, come out, and we would start serving the people. And I know it sounds crazy, but it changed sort of the whole vibe, for lack of a better word, of our bell staff. And we began to really serve people in a way that we hadn't served them before. And I'll be honest, a couple of things happened. It was more fun. Time went by faster at work. We enjoyed our jobs more. And honestly, we made more money because people were like, wow, we don't get service like this very often. And they would dig a little deeper. Now, what does that have to do with today's topic? Not making money, by the way. But the topic for today, when we discussed it a few weeks ago, Rick was proposing, well, why do we all, as speakers, talk about things that caused us to flourish in the faith. And immediately where my head went to, when I look back on my life, I got saved at about age 25, what caused me to sort of grow into the faith. And there's a lot of ways to explain what I mean by growing up, maturing in Christ, and becoming more embedded in the community and everything. Really, when I look back, it was through service. And so today's topic is basically called Flourishing Through Service. And I, you know, had a bunch of verses to choose from, but eventually I just settled on one, and it kind of became the no-brainer. This is it. It's a verse from the book of Ephesians, but I got to really set it up for you because, it, you know, like all verses, they don't just pop out of anywhere. There's a full context. So let me set it up like this. Paul, writing from prison in Rome, is writing letters. Now, he writes to the, you know, the Romans, and the letter to the Romans is sort of this broad, it appeals to any man or whatever. But to the church at Ephesus, he is specifically writing to a church that he founded, and he's writing to believers. And I'm not going to go through the whole point of the book of Ephesus is, but he starts his letter to the church at Ephesus with a section of scripture. It runs a little more than the first chapter, and it's called the Believer's Bank, or sometimes people call it the Believer's Checkbook. And it's basically this whole list of everything that God has given us, the believers. So what I'm going to do right now is, rather than read that whole chapter, I'm going to paraphrase it from the point of view of God, as if he were telling you everything he gave you. And check it out. It runs like this. Listen, I have given you every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies. Do you realize I chose you since before the beginning of everything that I created? And I chose you because I want you to be perfect and holy and righteous like me, because I love you. And I love you so much, it was my great pleasure to adopt you as my son or my daughter. And in fact, to do so, I had to buy you with the blood of my own son, my only begotten son, Jesus Christ. And because of that, all your sins are forgiven. On top of that, I have lavished you with grace and other spiritual gifts. And to help you understand this incredible mystery, I've given you the truth of my word, and I have sealed you with my Holy Spirit as a deposit for the inheritance and salvation that I have given you, so that it can never be taken away. And lastly, I'm in the process of opening the eyes of your heart that you might see and understand that with the same strength that I raised my son Jesus Christ from death to life is the same strength. Are you ready for that? The same strength which I'm activating in you now to live this life. Now, it's kind of like a wow moment. Like, isn't that wow? Like, it's like the ultimate Christmas or something. Like, it's so much, and it sort of begs the, what did I do to deserve that moment? Or if you were an unbeliever, you would probably be like, what do I got to do to get all that? And so to make it really clear, the next verse, I'm just going to read this one from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this not from yourselves. It's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Now, you guys have read the Bible, if you studied the Bible a little bit, these are famous verses, because there's this whole issue of faith and works and faith, and saved by faith and not saved by works. And it sums it all up here, that we all that great gifting we got was simply because of what we believe. Pistis is the Greek word for faith. And even that belief, God gave it to us, and so it can't be by works, by our labor, by what we do, and therefore no one can boast. And so we get to the end of that section, and again, you're kind of like, wow, he's done it all. He's given everything. And before Paul moves on to the next section of chapter 2, he adds one last verse that I want to read you right now. It's verse 10. He says, for we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, you could misunderstand this. If you didn't know that first part, it almost sounds like, oh, now we have to do stuff. Like, this could almost sound like a gotcha moment. Like, oh, I get it. You give us all this stuff, and now we have to do stuff. Now we owe you. So you're going to make us do stuff because you gave us all that stuff. Kind of like, you know, if somebody gives you something really cool and you're like, oh, now I got to give them something cool. Crap, you know. I can't say that in church. Sorry. But that doesn't work. In fact, it doesn't work. And in fact, by the way, notice I changed the punctuation of that verse. Now, just so you know, the punctuation is not considered inspired. I did not change the word of God. But normally they put the comma after good works. But to me it reads like, we're God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Oh, I get it, do works. And then you say which God prepared in advance for us to do. But I don't think that's the point of this verse. I think the point of this verse is God created us to do the work that he made for us. Now, do the math on this. He created each and every one of us. And then he created specific stuff that we would end up doing. Like, if I could sum it all up in one word, it's purpose. Which, by the way, is what everybody wants in life. What is my purpose? I mean, what's-his-face made millions on that, right? Or I guess he didn't make millions. He sold millions. The purpose-driven life, right? It's like, I was trying to think of, like, analogies and illustrations, you know, like a baby bird that, oh, I can fly, you know? And I, you know, visitors, I just got back from a two-week trip in New Zealand, and so, of course, I had to bring something up about that. And it actually came to me while I was there, while we were in this little town called Te Anau. We went across the lake to this cave where they have these things called glowworms. In fact, I'll show you a picture. This is the brochure that sucked us into buying the trip. And just so you know, it looked nothing like that, but whatever. But, you know, it's a two-hour trip. They charge you a few hundred dollars to go look at 5 minutes of glowworms. So, of course, they have to sort of stretch it out and, you know. And we got a whole lecture on the life cycle of a glowworm. And turns out, in fact, I was so interested, I actually had to raise my hand and make her repeat this, the gal that gave the lecture, that these little larvae get born in these, like, worms, and they exist for anywhere from 6 months to a year, glowing in the dark, where, you know, the glow attracts other flies and they zap them electronically and eat them or whatever, this and that. And then after about 6 months to a year, they form a cocoon, and that lasts for, I don't know, 30-odd days or so. And then you know what's going to happen next. They hatch into this little moth. It looks like more like a mosquito, but it's technically a moth. And it flies around for a day. Now, at first, when she was telling this whole story, I was thinking, oh, I could use this as a sermon illustration, like this little thing that discovers my true purpose, you know? But I was like, did she really say, like, one day? Like, that seems kind of crazy. So I raised my hand. Did you say one day? She goes, yeah. After, like, almost a year, they fly for one day, and then they die. In fact, if you really want to get, the biblical illustration thing going, then sometimes they sacrifice themselves to another worm. But we're not going there today. And she goes, yeah, because that's when they fulfill their purpose. And I go, what's their purpose? And she goes, they just mate till they die. Which I thought, well, that would make for a really awkward sermon illustration when we talk about your purpose in the Lord. But it works, doesn't it? God created you to do this thing that he created for you to do. Now, at this juncture of the sermon, like, let's be honest, you know, I create these things and you as the congregation begin to sort of expect what might be coming. We've been created to flourish in service. God creates us to do things that he created us for to do. We could go a few different directions, and you might be wondering which way I was going to go. Like, one of the way I could, you know, real obvious one is, and the church needs your help, right? We need you to sign up today to do whatever. I don't know, help us clean after the show tonight or something, which, by the way, we could actually use some help. But that's not the point today, yeah? Not the point. And that would be really obvious, except I want to ask you a question. Does God really need your help? No. He doesn't. God doesn't need us to fulfill his will. He uses us, those who are willing. But the point of this is not, yeah, God needs you. We can't do this without you. The point is this. God has created you to do these things. And when in doing these things, you are literally fulfilling your purpose, and that causes you to flourish in your life. So that's not the point today. Another point, another, you know, road we could have gone down is, what is your special purpose, you know? Can't say that without thinking of Steve Martin and The Jerk, but whatever. But what is your purpose? And you know, there's books and seminars discovering your spiritual gifts, but we kind of covered that earlier this year. Remember in 1 Corinthians, we covered all that. And so we're not going to go there either. A third way I could have gone was this. I could have gone, you know, and serving God is fun. And it's such a great way to get to know the people of the church, which is sort of true, except that serving God often is actually a great way to get offended, discouraged, disrespected, and even attacked by those dearest to you. And if you don't believe me, ask Paul. It happened to him all the time in his service. Some of you are like, I'm never signing up for anything ever again. So that's not the point either. Like, serve and you'll have a great time. The point today is serving God is a way to become flourishing in the life that he has for you. And I want to read you a couple different verses that are sort of going to bring this idea out, but slowly but surely. I want to start by reading to you from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 11 to 12. This is Paul. He says, you will be made rich in every way. Now, think about this. Just pause there for a second. Think of all the blessings I just told you God gave you in Ephesians 1. All those blessings, God says, I'm going to give you. I'm going to enrich you with all this. You will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in the many expressions of thanks to God. You're blessing people, and you're glorifying God. Now, the next verse I want to share with you at first seemed a little bit awkward. I sort of had to do some in-depth study because I wasn't sure if I was correct to talk about what I think it means. But let me show you Romans 15, 17. Paul again speaking. Therefore, he says, I glory in Christ Jesus in my service to God. Now, if you study scripture, if you like theology, you know that our job is always to glorify Christ. And so you read this and it almost sounds like saying Paul is getting a benefit, like he's glorifying in this, but it reads kind of funny. And I began to read it and study it and think it almost sounds like he's saying both things. And so I was so blessed when I went and studied some other commentators to find other guys, like much, much smarter than me, agreed with me. That it's almost like this two-way street, that as I serve God, and by doing helping people and serving God, I'm glorifying God, but I also am being glorified in him, because that's what the scripture teaches, that when we see him, we shall be like him. It's part of our process of growing, as it were. And so it strikes me as this incredible benefit that in Ephesians 1, when it gives you all the blessings and it ends with that verse, it's not like, and now you have to. But it's the idea that because I am God's workmanship created for good works, I believe that's the greatest blessing in that list. And now I become fulfilled in my service to God. I got a few stories for you. One's an old story. I know I told it a long, long time ago, but I wanted to bring it up again because I know he's kind of moved back to the island. In fact, I wonder is Sean Hoff here today? I didn't see him earlier, but Sean Hoff moved back to the island recently. He's married with kids now, but he was about 16 years old when this happened. And we were down in Mexico, just like the kids who just came back from Mexico. And we were standing on this woman's roof, which was basically a shack, in a slum in Tijuana, and Sean is on his knees pounding nails, and I'm standing over him, handing him whatever, I forget now if it was roof tiles or nails or whatever, and I'm looking around, and you know, it's so different. It's Tijuana, and it smells funny, and it looks different, and even the sounds are different, and it's just, wow, we're not in Poipu anymore, obviously, and Sean, at 16, goes, hey, Uncle Dain. I go, what? He goes, this is awesome. And I go, yeah, I know, pretty radical, huh? We're like in this, like, ghetto in Tijuana. It's kind of gnarly, huh? And then he gives me that look like, you know, only a teenager can give you, like, you idiot. He goes, no. He goes, this, putting a roof on this lady's house, this is awesome. Now, Sean, who's now in his 30s somewhere, who's still serving the Lord, I'd love to look back and think maybe that was the moment, you know, that the penny dropped. Like he got it. Like, and I, of course, was like, yeah. And you know, it's funny looking back in retrospect, you know, neither one of us are gifted that way. I mean, Sean didn't grow up to become some carpenter guy. And if you know me, as proved the last Mexico trip, all the girls could nail better than I can. It's not like God gifted us in roofing. We were just being obedient to God, serving who God gave us to serve. And I love that Sean, at age 16, he got it. This is where we flourish. And so God tells us this: I've filled up your account. I've poured into your account to provide spending opportunities, and he will create opportunities for you. And again, I don't want you to get lost on, yeah, I'm waiting to hear what that opportunity is, because you're never waiting for that opportunity. You're just being open to the ones that appear. Here's what I mean by that. Paul, you know, made tents. And I was trying to think about Paul sewing tents and what his attitude was. And was Paul making a tent going, really? This is it, Lord, with all my smarts? Because he was smart. I'm a genius, Lord. This is what you got for me? You know, I don't get the feeling he was doing that. I was trying to imagine in my head, what was Paul probably doing? And I bet he was doing this. I bet he was going, and Lord, how about Jacob over there? Boy, he could use some prayer. Lord, I lift up Jacob to you over there. Or maybe he was like composing those letters in his head, and he's thinking, those foolish Galatians, you know, who has bewitched you with some gospel that is no gospel at all? That's what I'm going to write them. Because it reminded me of something in my life. The first few years that I was a pastor, I used to park cars at the Marriott. It seems like I can't get out of that whole hotel thing, huh? Or wearing funny costumes, even to this day, whatever. And, it's not the most intellectually demanding job, obviously. And so sometimes if I knew I had to speak the next day, I would be reviewing and composing sermons in my head while I'm going about my job. And I remember one specific day, I was preaching through the book of Mark, and whatever, I don't remember the verse now, but I remember I was just kind of, you know, thinking about it, and a car pulls up, and I walk out, and I must be using about 10% of my brain or less. I go, aloha, folks, welcome to the Quiet Marriott. Where'd you come in from today? And they're like, New York. And I'm like, hey, all right, New York. My name's Dain, and I walk over to the gentleman. I'll be taking care of your bags and your car for you today. This ticket's for the car. This ticket's for the bag. So where'd you guys come in from today? And the guy's like, I just told you, New York. And I'm like, oh, yeah, embarrassing. And I was like humiliated because I wasn't there. So I jump in his car to go park his car, and I'm like, don't make that mistake again. And I'm kind of talking to the Lord. Well, I was prepping a sermon, Lord. And it's like God gave me this sense of, I know, but here's what I want you to do. I want you to serve the people right in front of you right now. Don't worry about your sermon tomorrow. I want you to be with the people that you're with right now, and I want you to serve them right now. And it's like one of those really small little things that I want to challenge you with this morning. Like, you don't need to worry about, well, isn't my gift this, and shouldn't I be doing this? And God's like, I've got stuff for you to do, but right now I want you to serve the people who are in front of you right now, your spouse, your kids, your boss, your teachers. And I began preparing this sermon this morning, looking back into what I told Rick. Well, I know what I'm going to speak on, because it was service that sort of brought me into the life of Christ. And I look back, the very first thing I ever did in this church was I signed up to drive the junior high van, which I know I've told a lot of stories from those days, yeah. And then I always like to tell this joke. You maybe heard me say it to you before, that, well, I started out driving the junior high van, and then I got promoted to cleaning the toilets, which tells you a lot about what driving the junior high van is like, right, youth workers? And here's the thing. It wasn't like I was cleaning toilets going, now this is a good use of my gifts. Or it wasn't like God is clearly using this time to prepare me for a ministry, because I didn't even want to be a pastor at that time. I hardly wanted to be a Christian at that moment, right? And it wasn't like, and this is how I will learn to flourish. No. I just started doing stuff, and cleaning toilets happened to be the thing that I was doing. And then when they asked me to sign up for that, all right, I'd do that. And little by little, getting involved with the body, I knew that I loved the body. And what I began to realize, especially looking back on it, not so much at the time, was what God was doing was he was teaching me to serve others, really for the first time in my life, to be a part of a community, but not just to be a taker and a receiver of that community, but to be giving into that community. And so with that in mind, and I was thinking oddly enough about scrubbing toilets in service, I just had this brainstorm about a scene I had seen in a movie one time. And I went back, and through the magic of YouTube, I went and found that clip, and I swear, it might be, I think, one of the greatest illustrations about service that I could ever think to create. It's not even a Christian clip. There's no mention of God or Jesus in it. A lot of you, especially if you over 55, will see something really familiar here in this. So without any introduction, I just want to show it to you, and then we'll extrapolate from it.
This is the largest group of people ever assembled in one place.
And in here. I'm sorry. Nobody in there. Okay. Somebody left their cane. Somebody left their cane in here. That poor Bumblebee. Come looking for his cane.
Behind on this job, aren't you? Oh, they've been behind right along. It's not
the idea of being behind. You just can't keep up. That's what it is.
You're using quite a bit of that stuff, huh?
Yeah. That helps give you a little pleasanter odor, you know. Yeah, with the disinfectant in there, you put your deodorant balls in. Makes it a little more pleasanter to go in there and use it.
Well, doing a good job here.
Thank you very much. Glad to do it for these kids. My son's here too. And I got one over in Vietnam too. He's up in the DMZ right now called flying helicopters.
Thank you.
Do I even need to explain it? I almost cry when I watch that clip. I know that sounds really cornball, and why? It's because I've watched that whole movie. It's like 3.5 hours, and there's whole sense of this is Woodstock was a really important thing. You know, Jimi Hendrix playing the Star Spangled Banner at dawn. Whoa. And we kind of worship that whole idea. As it turned out, the idea of Woodstock was a great big giant disaster for our country. It really was. And notice in the film, they're mocking him. Hey, getting a little behind on this. Ha, ha, ha. Get it? Do you get the joke? Getting a little behind? And he goes right over his head, doesn't even notice. He's too busy doing his job. And he turns around and he faces the camera. And here he is doing the most humiliating job of the million-odd people there, the thing that nobody else wanted to do. And he's beaming with joy. And he says, I'm doing it for the kids. Oh, by the way, I got another one in Vietnam. The idea of service and sacrifice, you could see, ran through the family and even to his kid as well. And I'm so humbled by that. And it's to me, it's such a beautiful picture of flourishing in service of others. And, you know, imagine if he said, oh, I do it for the Lord. We would have just been like, yeah, boom, you know. But it's almost didn't need to go there because you saw the joy on his face doing the worst possible things because he was doing it for others, that we are God's workmanship, created to do the very things that he created us to do. And I go back to that hotel illustration that's kind of silly and dumb, and yet, do you get the point? We had a change of mindset in what it meant to serve customers coming to the hotel. And it wasn't just that we made more money, and sometimes we did, and sometimes we didn't, and when we didn't care anymore, because it was just a blessing to be able to bless people and welcome them to San Diego, and people excited to be there, and us to be there for them. We are God's workmanship. He made us, And then he blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavens, and the sealing of the Holy Spirit, the being seated in the heavenlies with the family of God. And the last blessing he gives us is something to do that he created for us to do. And when we do that, we flourish. And so I shouldn't have to say anything else, because if, you know, good sermons end with a challenge and an encouragement. The challenge is obvious. Where is God calling you to serve? Not 20 years from now. Where's God calling you to serve? And who is he calling you to serve right now? That's the challenge. The encouragement is obvious. Serve God and be blessed. Be blessed. Glorify in Jesus as he does his work through you. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for this encouraging and challenging message here this morning, Lord. That we can serve you in just the tiniest or largest ways, Lord. And we recognize it's not always easy. It doesn't bring instant results. It's not always fun. And yet that was never your point, God. Your point is to have us serve the purpose for which you created us. To find it simply by looking for what it is you have us to do. Serving the very people who are right in front of us, and in doing so, becoming your hands and your voice. As my brother David even said, my illusionist brother today, that it might be through the things we do more so than the things we say, that people might see you living in us, be drawn to you. Ultimately, that is what will glorify you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Everybody said amen. And we'll see you at 3 o'clock today for some fun. Have a great Sunday, you guys.